Bună ziua! Bine ați venit în județul Neamț! Bine ați venit la Piatra Neamț! Mă numesc Anca Afloarei, sunt șef serviciu turism în cadrul Consiliului Județean Neamț și împreună cu toți colegii mei suntem gazda dumneavoastră pe parcursul acestor 3 zile. Evenimentul de astăzi, cea de-a treia întâlnire a membrilor EDEN, care se va desfășura în aceste zile la Piatra Neamț, este organizat în perioada în care România exercită președinția rotativă a Consiliului Uniunii Europene. Prin urmare, organizatorii sunt Comisia Europeană, Ministerul Turismului și Consiliul Județean Neamț. Iar reprezentanții tuturor acestor instituții doresc să vă adreseze un cuvânt de bun venit. Începem cu doamna Cristina Târteață, secretar de stat în cadrul Ministerului Turismului.
Welcome to Romania, and that will be it in English. Let's switch to Romanian because you only have the 10 seconds. Bună dimineața și bine ați venit la cea de 13-a ediție a întâlnirii Reserei Destinației Europene de Excelență EDEN, care se desfășoară aici, la Piatra Neamț, principalul oraș din Ținutul Neamțului, o destinație EDEN care a fost premiată de 2 ori în 2 ani, respectiv în 2008 și în 2015. Așa cum a spus și predecesoarea mea, cea care a vorbit înaintea mea, într-adevăr, este al doilea eveniment pe care îl desfășurăm în marja deținerii președinției Consiliului UE. Primul eveniment a avut loc la București săptămâna trecută și s-a numit Turismul Durabil, Politici Comune ale Statelor Membre ale Uniunii Europene. Urmează să avem și un al treilea eveniment, respectiv o conferință ministerială în Delta Dunării, undeva în luna iunie, la Tulcea mai exact. Ea se va desfășura sub tema Strategia Dunării, instrumente de dezvoltare economică. Deci, așa cum observați, am încercat să acoperim în decursul deținerii acestei președinții aproape toată țara. Nu am vrut să facem evenimentele într-un singur loc, pentru că toți știm că România este o țară deosebit de frumoasă, iar cei care sunt astăzi prezenți, invitații noștri și cei care vor avea dezbaterile astăzi, au ocazia să vadă doar o mică bucățică din ea. Tocmai de aceea, deși vremea nu ne ajută foarte mult, din păcate zilele acestea, îi invit să revină oricând și cu mare drag în România, să vadă și celelalte frumosețe ale partei noastre. Mă bucur că sunt astăzi cea care dă startul dezbaterilor din cadrul acestei reuniuni. Așa cum v-am zis, știu că ieri ați fost într-o vizită și vremea v-a ajutat, cel puțin în perioada vizitei, să vedeți frumoasele trei ale Picasului. Este într-adevăr o zonă de o frumusețe incredibilă, cu care România, din fericire, a fost binecuvântată. Avem acolo Parcul Național Cheile Picasului, care este una dintre ariile protejate din România pentru conservarea biodiversității și a peisajului, a speciilor valoroase, fiind în același timp și o țară recunoscută la nivel internațional pentru patrimoniul UNESCO România, având 6 situri culturale și 2 situri naturale, dar tot pe teritoriul țării noastre existând și 14 parcuri naționale și 17 parcuri naturale. Așa cum am spus, sunteți așteptați oricând să reveniți în calitate de vizitatori împreună cu rude, prieteni, să le vizitați pe toate. Vă va lua ceva timp, vreau să vă spun asta. În calitate de stat membru al Uniunii Europene, România a participat la toate cele 8 ediții ale concursului EDEN și a reușit să obțină titlul de destinație de excelență pentru 34 de obiective turistice. Vorbeam și cu doamna Cirma de la Comisia Europeană că, într-adevăr, România este o destinație foarte activă în proiectul EDEN și noi ne bucurăm că toată țara este implicată în acest proiect. Nu am să enumăr exact anii și temele care s-au perindat de-a lungul anilor, dar vă fac așa o scurtă prezentare. De exemplu, în 2008 am luat, pentru prima oară am participat la tema cu turismul și mobilitatea locală intangibilă și Ținutul Neamțului a luat locul 4 atunci în 2008 și fiindcă toți suntem în Neamț, în 2015 pentru tema turismul și gastronomia locală, tot locul 4, județul Neamț. Deci județul Neamț este unul din județele fruntașe care de fiecare dată participă și se pare cu rezultate notabile. Au fost premii apoi în 2009, 2010, 2012, de două ori în 2012 cu turismul și regenerarea siturilor fizice, dar și cu turismul rural. În 2013, am spus de 2015 și în 2017 cu tema turismul cultural tangibil. Așa cum vedeți, porniți de la destinațiile premiate și temele concursurilor, vă puteți imagina varietatea formelor de turism pe care țara noastră le poate oferi. Fiecare tema a concursului servește pentru a prezenta diversitatea Europei, inclusiv resursele naturale, moștenirea istorică, tradițiile și gastronomia locală, iar România este, din fericire, una din țările care le are pe toate acestea. În afară de asta, ne putem mândri cu o mulțime de locuri spectaculoase, cu resurse bogate, cu simboluri cu o semnificație aparte, unice în lume. Oricine ne vizitează țara poate găsi munți și dealuri uimitoare, câmpii vaste, o varietate de forme de relief care sunt ideale pentru orice iubitor de natură. Însă România nu este doar despre forme de relief. România este și despre oamenii care o locuiesc, despre faptele și cuvintele lor. În prezent, la nivelul instituției pe care o reprezint, la Ministerul Turismului, derulăm două proiecte EDEM cu finanțare europeană, și anume România Eden Destinations Promotion, campanie de promovare a destinațiilor Eden selectate până în prezent. Proiectul acesta se va derula pe o perioadă de 18 luni, între septembrie 2018 și februarie 2020. Iar cel de-al doilea proiect este vorba de România Eden Contest 2019, concursul Eden 2019, cu tema Health and Wellbeing Tourism. Proiectul durează pe o perioadă de 10 luni, în perioada aprilie 2019, ianuarie 2020. Doar v-am enumerat numele proiectelor, mai târziu, în cadrul dezbaterilor de astăzi, colega mea de la Ministerul Turismului vă va face o prezentare detaliată a ceea ce înseamnă proiectele EDEN în România și pentru Ministerul Turismului. Obiectivele urmărite de noi, ca și Ministerul Turismului, se aseamănă în mare parte cu obiectivele urmărite de proiectul EDEN, și vizează, evident, dezvoltarea turismului durabil, decongestionarea destinațiilor clasice, reducerea sezonalității, redirecționarea fluxurilor de turiști către destinații non-tradiționale. În România punem foarte mare accent pe sustenabilitatea turismului, așa cum v-am spus, chiar tema de săptămâna trecută a conferinței care a avut loc la București a fost despre turismul sustenabil și am văzut în panelurile pe care le veți dezbate astăzi că se vorbește, evident, și despre turismul sustenabil, deci este o componentă foarte importantă pe care noi o avem în vedere. Iar în acest sens, campania de promovare a țării noastre se construiește în jurul devizei România, o destinație timp de 365 de zile pe an. Deci încercăm să reducem sezonalitatea, este un obiectiv nu numai al nostru, dar al și tuturor celorlalte țări care se confruntă cu sezonalitate. Vrem să mutăm fluxul de turiști din sezon în extra-sezon. Așa cum știți, în general, vara și iarna sunt destinațiile cele mai anotimpurile cu destinațiile cele mai căutate în România. Dar, fiind că România, așa cum am spus de foarte multe ori, are extraordinar de multe de oferit, începând cu balneo, cu turismul balneo, care poate fi efectuat 365 de zile pe an, fără nicio problemă. Ne putem duce și face tot felul de tratamente, începând de la anti-aging sau tot felul de tratamente pentru întreținerea sănătății, pentru prevenție. Acestea le puteți efectua în România, care deține și o treime din apele naturale și minerale ale Europei, fără probleme pe toată perioada anului. Dar, evident, și gastronomia locală, turismul rural, toate acestea se pot efectua 365 de zile pe an și asta promovează Ministerul Turismului. În fine, nu rămâne decât să vă doresc dezbateri fructuoase și sunt absolut convinsă că inputul furnizat în urma acestor dezbateri va fi unul valoros pe care îl veți putea folosi în continuare la celelalte dezbateri EDEN, poate și pentru a reuși să adăugați noi teme în acest concurs, toate evident sub deviza turismului sustenabil. Vă mulțumesc încă o dată că ați decis să participați într-un număr atât de mare. Vă doresc dezbatem fructuoasă, așa cum ați spus, și o vreme bună mâine, atunci când veți avea ocazia să mai vedeți o mică parte din frumusețile pe care Ținutul Neamțului și România le are de oferit. Mulțumesc frumos!
Mulțumim, doamnei secretar de stat. Dăm cuvântul domnului Ion Asaptei, vicepreședinte al Consiliului Județean Neamț.
Stimați invitați, doamnelor și domnilor, suntem urască cea de-a 13-a reuniune a rețelei EDEL, organizată de Comisia de Ministerul Turismului și Consiliul Județean, are loc aici în Ținutul Neamțului, într-un județ apreciat ca fiind unul dintre cele mai frumoase din România. Ne gândim la turism ca la una dintre posibilitățile de excepție pentru creșterea nivelului de trai, pentru creșterea economică a țării, iar la acest eveniment, prioritatea noastră este prezentarea prestigiului istoric, a prestigiului cultural, a posibilităților de relaxare și, în ultimul rând, a sentimentului inedictului absolut pentru cei care vor simți și vor trăi, însă cea mai frumos al cuvântului, ca turiști pe aceste mele. Județul Neamț să se reunit pentru o traserie de excepții către mănăstirile din zonele limitrofe ale orașului Târgu Neamț și orașului Piatra Neamț. Mănăstiri care reprezintă pentru noi perle ale creștinismului. Este reunit de asemenea pentru masivul cerului, un munte solitar, sfânt pentru români, cu energii pozitive nebăluite, care ne-au dat la prezenții milenare a Bunului Dumnezeu în spațiul românesc. Ceahlăul este un munte străluit de trasee splendide, cu un parc național vestit în țară și în lume. Lângă Mănăstirea Neamț, turiștii pot admira zimbrii în habitatul lor natural. Zimbrii acesefalnice animale reprezintă simbolul părăției a forții marilor noștri dăuritori. Nu departe se află zidirea lui Ștefan cel Mare, cetatea Neamț, unde cel ce bate la porțile edificiului este întâmpinat de gățele și căieșii voievodului. Foarte aproape este casa memorială cu leagurul copilării scriitorului clasic al literaturii române, Ion Crea. În orice loc al județului, să ne afla turiștii, pot vizita muzee, pot afla despre civilizația Cultei, o civilizație veche de peste 6.000 de ani, caracterizată de o frumusețe aparte, pot vizita case memoriale, vestigii ale arhitecturii rurale autentice, biserici de lemn și alte minunății ale tradițiilor culturale unice în toată lumea, monumente rare. De asemenea, altă bogăție o reprezintă apele termale de la stațiunea Bălțătești, unde se efectuează tratament balnear pe tot parcursul anului. După cum vedeți, în această prezentare de o sinteză absolută, avem cu ce ne mândri. Nu degeaba județul Neamț a fost premiat la nivel național în anii 2016-2015 pentru atractivitate turistică, iar în anul 2018 a fost desemnat destinație europeană de excelență. Preocuparea noastră pentru atragerea turiștilor în zonă este constantă. Consiliul Județean Neamț păstrează pe agenda sa acest domeniu în permanență, și astăzi, având astfel de oaspeți la noi în județ, ne manifestăm dorința, dar și certitudinea că despre turismul nemțean se va vorbi la superlativ în țările pe care dumneavoastră le reprezentați. Vă mulțumim în prezență și vă așteptăm să vă bucurați de locuri frumoase, de oameni minunați și ospitali etici. Vă mulțumesc pentru atenție!
Mulțumim și noi. În continuare, doamna Daniela Soroceanu, prefect al județului Neamț, reprezentantul guvernului în teritoriu.
Bine ați venit în județul Neamț, leagă de mică și al copilării copilul universal, cum zicea George Călinescu. Bun venit în Petrogava, cetatea dacilor liberi. Bun venit la poalele muntelui Ceahlău. După Atos, cel de-al doilea mare munte sfânt al creștinismului ortodox. Avem istorie, legendă și spiritualitate românească peste tot în județul nostru. Simțim românește, fie că avem moștile meșterului Nicolae Popa de la Târpești, fie că ne încântăm privind bătuta moldovenească sau floricică de la munte, sau când vedem cum argila se transformă în vase de cuptei. Cine nu l-a citit pe Ion Creangă de la Hunulești? Fără poveștile și amintirile din copilărie, literatura noastră și chiar aș îndrăzni să spun, chiar și cea universală a fi mult mai sărace. Asta pentru că nica lui Ștefana Petri este Tom Sawyer, al lui Mark Twain, este Poe, al lui Edmondo de Amicis, sau chiar Gavroș, al lui Victor Hugo. Aveți ocazia în aceste zile să mergeți pe drumul de munte, asemenea lui Calistrat Hogaș, un alt reper al literaturii române, cel care a descris mirific, pădurile și locurile acestea. Ca să înțelegeți dimensiunea istorică a prezenței dumneavoastră aici, vă spun că ne aflăm la niciun kilometru de părcare, de turnul și biserica actitorită de Ștefan cel Mare și Sfânt, în a cărui domnie, 1457-1504, Moldova a reprezentat ultimul avantpost al creștinătății în calea cuceririlor otomane. Ștefan a titulit de o biserică după fiecare bătălie câștigată împotriva potrivitorilor. Și a fost un domn respectat. Un om nu mare la stat și de dragă vărsătorul de sânge, așa cum ilustrau cronicarii. Un exemplu în acest sens este și mănăstirea Războin, la câțiva kilometri de Piatra Neamt. Drumul vă va duce prin cheile Picasului, unde sper să vă simțiți ca la Plitvice, locul fascinant unde s-a pus în scenă pe peliculă povestea lui Vinetu și a comorii din lacul de argint. Veți ajunge prin Contrineanțului, în Ținutul Zimbrului, acolo unde, grație eforturilor autorităților, a fost salvată și redată naturii această specie, cu nimic mai prejos decât bizonul. În Ținutul Neamțului și în Ținutul Zimbrului stă de strajă de veacuri cetatea Neamțului, cea care niciodată nu a fost cucerită. Doar 19 plăiești poldavi s-au opus în 1691, întregi armate a regiului Polonia Sovietică. Spiritualitatea județului nostru nu va copleși pentru că aici se găsește cea plăul muntele Sfânt al Dacilor, cei mai drepți și mai înțelepți dintre traci, cum îi descria Marele Herodot. El este Cogaionul, muntele legendar și plin de similitudini mistice cu piramidele de la Gisec din Egipt. Norul coboară pe muntele Sfânt, precum se întâmplă pe Tabor, la marea sărbătoare a schimbării la față, fenomenul uitor care se petrece doar pe 6 august în fiecare an. Ne mândrim cu Ticul Cătușului, nemțeanul nostru, primul alpinist și geolog care a cucerit Everestul. Ne mândrim cu Ionuț Lăghian, cel care intră în istorie pentru descoperirea celor mai vechi fosile ascunse în adâncurile pământului. Pământ pe care, spre exemplu, un alt explorator și un alt geolog, exploratorul portughez Vasco da Gama, l-a înconjurat și l-a învins. Credința și spiritualitatea sunt la tot coastul. Am putea spune că asceții din peștera și, și schitul Sfântei Teodora de la Sicla ar putea, spre exemplu, să ne amintească de jertfa și devotamentul lor într-o păstrarea credinței. Așa cum și cavalerii de Malta când au pornit spre Ierusalim spre virința creștinismului. Ortodoxia românească se mândește cu mănăstirea Neamț, cu cea de la Agapia, de la Petru Vodă și Sihăstria, Secu, Coraița sau Bistrița. În aceste lăcașuri își duc somnul de veci mari voievozi, precum Alexandru cel Bun, mari cărturari, precum Mitropolitul Varlam sau cronicarul Grigore Orege. Unii i-ar putea spune acestuia că a scris letopisețul țării Moldovei fiind un fiind cunoscător al vremurilor istorice, pentru că a trăit alături de mari conducători ai țării, cărora le-a fost sfetnic, cum a fost voievodul Vasile Lupu, deținând funcții politice. I-a analizat și le-a consemnat faptele. Aș îndrăzni să-l asemănesc cu Nicolo Machiavelli, părintele științelor politice moderne, cel care a scris Principele, cel care, după ce a stat în preajma marilor oameni politici ai statelor italieni din secolul al XVI-lea, a scris romane. Iar dacă în călătoria noastră veți pluti pe ritmul de simfonie, acest lucru se datorează unui alt gen universal, dirijorul Sergiu Celibidache, născut pe aceste meleaguri. Și-am mai fi multe de spus despre Neamțul meu drag. Vă las însă să-l descoperiți dumneavoastră. Am onoarea și privilegiul de a vă ura bun venit în Neamț. Pentru mine înseamnă acasă. Mulțumesc!
Mulțumim, doamne prefect! și nu în ultimul rând, reprezentantul Comisiei Europene, doamna Ghirma Anușcheviciute, coordonator al proiectului EDEM în cadrul Comisiei Europene. Mulțumim, doamnă, că sunteți astăzi alături de noi.
Prefect of Neamt County Council and Vice President of the County Council, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. So good morning and a very welcome, a very warm welcome to the EDEM Network meeting. It is already our 13th meeting that we organize for the EDEM Network, and fingers crossed, number 13 will bring us only luck today. So let me start by saying that the European Commission attaches great importance to tourism as a strong contributor to growth and jobs in the European Union. And the development of sustainable tourism is one of our targets. We have been working since many years towards the promotion of sustainable development of the tourism sector by implementing numerous initiatives. We want more sustainable, innovative, and competitive European tourism. So what do we do at European level in this field of sustainable tourism? First of all, we work with the aim to enhance investment in sustainable tourism with the use of EU financial support. Our direct program is COSME, under which EDEM is funded. We also want to support the adaptation of tourism businesses to the digital shift and ensure a responsible and sustainable development of new business models in respect of local communities. We also want to improve skills, including green skills, and help the tourism industry to retain talents. And last but not least, we want to increase tourism flows to the European Union through our diversification of the EU tourism offer and joint promotion of Europe as a sustainable destination. Through our targeted actions such as EDEN or our new initiative called European Capitals of Smart Tourism, we facilitate the exchange of best practices in sustainable tourism between destinations. For example, this year, the winner of this new competition called European Capitals of Smart Tourism, which are Lyon and Helsinki, they will play a role model and inspire other EU destinations to adopt innovative measures in sustainable tourism. Furthermore, sustainable cultural tourism was highlighted as one of the 10 initiatives of the European Year of Cultural Heritage, and I'm looking at Helga because she was part of the working group comprising 23 member states who worked on a report to present policy recommendations for the policymakers and practitioners on sustainable cultural tourism. The report should be available very soon, and we will be happy to share it with you. And last but not least, this year we plan to boost capacity in of tourism SMEs, small and medium-sized enterprises. So we will launch a call for proposals in a couple of months, so follow our website if you're interested. And we will be funding projects on transnational cooperation and knowledge transfer in sustainable tourism. And now, coming back to EDEN. So 13 years down the line, EDEN is still a very successful European project that we're very proud of, and I'm personally working on it since very the beginning. So EDEN at present has 150 winning destinations and up to 500 runner-up destinations. And we are here in one of the runner-up destinations. Thanks to our all common efforts, EDEN project has been gaining more and more visibility in Europe. EDEN destinations are active in their national EDEN networks. So they are supported by enthusiastic national EDEN project officers, and there are a few of them here, as well as EDEN ambassadors. And another important benefit of the EDEN initiative is the opportunity for the destinations to join the EDEN Network Association. Examples of such activities and achievements of the EDEN Network Association will be illustrated today throughout the day. In the annual EDEN meetings like this one today, you have the opportunity to share your experiences and expectations and to look for ways to work together. So we hope that this meeting will be yet another opportunity for you to learn from each other and with each other.
Now I want to thank everybody who helped us to make this event possible. A big thank to the Ministry of Tourism, the Neamt County Council, and the City of Piatra Neamt, and especially to Julia and Anka and their teams who worked hard to make this event possible. I'm sure I can speak on behalf of everybody by expressing our admiration for your professionalism and hospitality. And I thank the EDNC Network Association members for your continuous cooperation with us and inspiration. You will hear from me just in a few minutes again. I will give you a more concrete state of play on the EDNC project, the proposals and where we are with them. But I would like now to pass the floor. It's now, yes, time for the EDN.
It's 10 o'clock.
Ah, okay, sorry. But yes, now it will be the president who will take over and will be chairing the rest of the morning session. So I wish you us all a successful event. And thank you.
Mulțumim, doamnei Ghirma. În continuare se vor desfășura lucrările întâlnirii propriu-zise a membrilor EDEN, cu toate sesiunile precizate în programul pe care dumneavoastră l-ați primit. Pentru aceasta rog trei cei reprezentanți ai organizatorilor să ia loc în sală și să invităm în prezidiu speakerii, în frunte cu domnul Xavier Le Chien, președintele Asociației EDEN. Bine ați venit la noi, domnule președinte.
Very slowly for all trajectories to be able to follow the rhythm of my speech. Thank you, by the way, for your translations. Let me first thank the national and local authorities for the organization of this meeting. We have known for years the professional implication of Julia. It is confirmed that you are all very engaged in the Eden network, and we welcome it warmly. Thank you, Romania. Merci. It's a real honor to be here in the east of Eden. Welcome in a beautiful rural area that reminds us the hidden gems of Europe. It shows us also the importance of being visible to customers and visitors, as the competition is so high in the field of tourism. And still, our goal is to attract visitors, sometimes no more, but better visitors. Maximilian will tell us this afternoon how Piatra Neamt has become one of the best examples to follow social media management. Our network is also about benchmarking. It is not a secret. This year is crucial for Europe. Brexit is not yet over. And the result of the next pause in late May have never been so unsure. But our mission is not about politics. It is to act. It is to work for the future of our destinations, as we decided in 2012 when we began to run this network almost by ourselves. Almost. Because we couldn't have never been so far without the support of the European Commission. Thank you sincerely, Guillaume.
My pleasure.
But what does it mean? For those in the room who are not yet familiar with this network, the European Commission launched a very nice idea in 2006 to promote small-sized destinations off the beaten tracks, places and villages, willing to promote their destination through tourism. In 2012, some of these awarded destinations decided to make a step forward. We became an official network, an international association under the Belgian law, who cares about their local communities, local environmental protection and support of local economy. At the end of 2018, this network was about 71 destinations in 22 countries. This is what about the map is. And you will receive later on this leaflet, which shows you the map in another size, but you can have it as well with me. Today, we are 89, just 2 months after the end of 2018, as the Croatian National Tourism Board decided to support 24 of their destinations through the Eden network. Thank you very much, Croatia. And if you have some question to Ivana, she can explain to you how she succeed to convince the authorities of Croatia to make such a support for our association and for their destinations first. Also, Ireland is doing the same, as supporting 8 or 9 destinations, 9 winners through all the countries. Thank you also. But something new has emerged since last year. It is called Youth for Climate. A new energy is growing from the basis, from all children. They want another world, and they are right. And that's why we have to implement new management in our destinations. Why don't we try self-assessment? Are we not able to measure development of our own destinations? Remember last year, we talked about green destination and blue economy. We talked about mass tourism, over tourism. And nowadays, local populations in many places organize themselves to suggest new solutions for local development. It's about creating a new deal with local politicians. But even in our small-sized destination, it is not so easy to implement it. I will share shortly an example from my destination, Gurwe, in the middle of the Belgian Ardennes. This is the city of Gurwe, a middle-aged town surrounded by the forest of the Ardennes, between Liège and Bastogne, if you have an idea of our country. As the DMO of Gurwe, I took part last year to the global top 100 for the sustainable destination. I filled in all the criteria as it is based on self-assessment. I wanted to know how could Gurwe be evaluated. And to my surprise, it was recognized as one of the 100 best destinations in the world regarding sustainable development. We were very proud. Faial in the Azores, Portugal, and Kuldīga in Latvia did also the same 4 years ago. In this evaluation process, one of the criteria is about social management. It was an opportunity for me to mention a specific collaborative approach we are managing. We implemented 12 years ago a roundtable of tourism, where all the stakeholders of tourism and even the local population have debated about the development of tourism. Just a place for discussion and counseling, nothing related to discussion, to decision. And last month, just before the press conference where this logo was presented, our mayor asked me not to talk about this round table. He was not sure whether it would be maintained. It sounded incredible to me. Was he afraid of dialogue? One of the reasons is probably due to a non-local billionaire who is investing a lot in hotels and restaurants. And this project is not so welcomed by the local population. So with suspense, I will tell you next year how we will sort it out, because it's not yet over. My purpose was to talk about a new contract with local decision makers and how we can influence it, taking into account the local population interest. I think that being sustainable is all about that. As managers of destination, we have to care about it. That's why I think we should focus more on finding right tools to measure sustainable tourism. Do we have to wait from private sector to take the leadership? Have a look at the Green Leader Program at TripAdvisor or at Airbnb. Are they right? I went last month to the European Showcase Conference in Brussels. Very interesting. Everybody was talking about sustainable tourism, and most of them share valid points. How could our destinations be credible about sustainable tourism? Isn't it our greatest challenge to overcome? Do you want, like I do, that our even network becomes a reference regarding sustainable tourism? In other words, could you tell me how we are different and how we can prove it? That will be the exercise of the afternoon with the presentation of Anna Pollock, which is not, which, did you talk about it? Anna Pollock? Well, Kilian, yeah, but one of the afternoon experts will not be there, but her presentation will be read by our friends, Kilian, And the other expert will be, is there, Gloria. So I said, you will hear about sustainable and self-assessment this afternoon. And Kilian, our moderator, will surely make the best of it. So believe me, I will consider this meeting as a success if at least, for example, 10 destinations engage themselves in a self-assessment of sustainable tourism of your own. We have no choice anymore. Maximilian will tell you later that his website is becoming more and more popular regarding ecotourism and sustainable tourism. There are real keywords exploding on the website. Here just I wanted to show you, it is not maybe very clear, I just write down sustainable tourism on Google and more than 24 million suggestions came to me. This meeting is also an opportunity to discover good practices among members. That's the reason behind our Eating Innovation Program contest. Elga, our vice president, will tell you how much our experience is worth sharing. Youth for Climate is asking us to be restrictive regarding our energy consumption, to be more local or responsible in our transport, for example. But does it mean our children will have to skip traveling? Do we have to give up low-cost flights? Maybe in some way. But I would like also to encourage them to keep on traveling, because it is the start of discovering others, their culture and their habits. And the world is a book, and those who do not travel read only one page. I wish you a very pleasant meeting. Thank you.
Under which we selected 158 winners already. Then we provide grants for promotion of Eden destinations at national level. And then last but not least, we support the organization of Eden Network meetings. So now let's have a look where we are with all these activities in 2019. So I will start with Eden promotion. We have currently 12 member states that organize transnational awareness raising campaigns, including Romania. And several project officers are present here today, so maybe during the day they could share with us where you stand with these promotions, because they started already in September and they will last until March, April 2020. And the total budget of this action was $500,000. Then we have launched a new edition for selection on health and well-being tourism. And here we have 16 countries participating. They are listed here. For us, it's a little bit of a regret, because we would normally have about 20, even 22, 25 member states countries participating in these projects, but several countries are undergoing major reorganization, like Hungary, Italy, France, so they, unfortunately they stepped out of the project, and it's a pity for So there will be 16 new destinations selected by February, January next year in health and well-being tourism, and we will award them in Brussels on the 1st, 2nd of April. Yes, now as regards the Eden 2019-20 budget, we thought it's time to have an evaluation of this whole initiative. It's been already 30 years that we're running this project, so let's see how efficient is it still relevant? So, and we also want to gather some results from you and on the impacts and benefits of this initiative, and maybe to have some recommendations for how we should continue this project in the future. So you might be contacted, both Eden destinations and Eden project officers, by our contractor. So we are planning to sign the contract in June 2019, so, and the project will run for more or less 9 months. And due to this, we will not have a new edition in 2020, so we will have a short break, because really we want to see what the results of this evaluation will be. And then we will... We will also launch an Eden... we will launch a European-wide awareness raising and promotional campaign. Because what we noticed is that not all the countries participated in these national awareness campaigns that we were co-funding in 2011, 13, 15, and 17. So here we will take things in our hands. So we will launch a European-wide campaign to strengthen the Eden brand and to increase the visibility of all Eden destinations across all the themes and across all the participating countries. And the activities will probably be around social media, an online campaign, participation in several major tourism fairs, advertising, and the budget is over $1 million, but keeping in the mind that we have 158 destinations to promote, it's not so big. And then I already know that our next Eden events will be, in April 2020. So we will organize the next Eden Network meeting also on the same occasion. And we will group all the events. It will be our European Tourism Day, European Eden Award Ceremony, and Network meeting. And there we will greet the new winners and runners up from the Eden Health and Wellbeing edition. So that was it from me, just a quick update on where we are. Thank
with his young family more than 10 years ago, and they
continued to say that this was the most beautiful holiday they ever had in their life. So I think it's really good that we are in Romania. Thank you very much. And now I would like to tell you something about the Innovation Prize of the Eden Network. Before I start showing you the slides, I just tell you some things about the prize itself. What means innovation? Because we call it Innovation Prize. Innovation can be, of course, very different. It can be technically or technological. It can be economical, social. In the leader context, I'm working for a leader group, a local action group. It, of course, it's more social. But whatever it is, it always means it should be somehow non-conformistic and it should bring new ideas. So in this context, we are organizing the ERT for our members in order to give them a floor to show their good practices and to share with us and the world what they are going and what they are achieving. And we can learn from members and from the good practice, and we can get inspired by it. And we also, of course, support the winners of the EIP to get to spread the good news through our website, through word of mouth propaganda, and of course, ideally also via our partner, European Best Destinations. In this year's, our topics in this year were three. The first was about good practice, about sustainable tourism indicator implementation. Our idea was that at least some of the Eden destinations have already certain indicators and they are measuring their sustainability. The point is that we got only two applications and they did not really answer our questions. And I have to say I'm sorry because I was not specific enough in my explaining our expectations, but this will be the next time for sure different. We will be very specific. But still the experiences are interesting. So the next was a new trend in tourism. Offers for the LGBT, this means lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender community. This community is a trendsetter, and this community is spending lots of money on travel. So I really think it is good to think about this community and how to attract them, how to be, to share them, our tolerance and openness to every person. And so we wanted to know if there are even destinations that have already experience in this field. And the third question was, or the third topic was, offers for the silver generation. Of course, we had the most, the so-called silver generation. And a good example for it. It means persons over like 60, and they are traveling much more now. I remember my mother, she would have liked to travel, but she was not able to. But now it's actually people who are 60 feel like 40 or maybe 50. And so really we have to think about this community and to make nice offers for them. And so I present to you now the applications we got. Some of them, unfortunately, were not very specific, so they were not really answering our questions and did not really refer to the topic, so we show you the best. And late in the afternoon, you will hear who is the winner and what the winners will get. And of course, you can also ask me questions if you have, because unluckily, We did not even have one application from Romania, and I hope this will change. So the first I would like to tell you about is from Ireland. It's called the Scattery Island, and it's an uninhabited island in the very west in the Atlantic of Ireland. And they are offering tours to the island. You can go there with a ferry. And they are really trying very hard to keep all the waste away from the island. So you get even the possibility to purchase a packed lunch in a cooler bag. And everything is locally produced and prepared. And all the rubbish goes back to the pack and is to the bag and is then selected. So they have a monthly Clean Coast initiative. So people who are working for them for free, and they really clean the coast every month. And they have this policy of no trace. So don't leave any trace when you visit the island. They serve coffee or tea on the ferry with compostable cups and lids. No plastic is used. They make special children education. And they have no devices for, they have of course audio tours, but no devices that you can download from the website. All the information on your mobile phone, and so you don't need these plastic pieces or devices to walk on the island and get the information. And they also have a very nice cooperation with the local retailers on the mainland. And with a ferry ticket, guests get discount on the products they sell. So here you see the bags, with the cooler bags, which you can get at the ferry. Here you have a picture of the island, which is really picturesque. They have a lot of historic sites on the island, and although it's not inhabited, it's everything possible to see and to experience. Here you see the action with the volunteers who are cleaning the island every month. And this is a photo from the children's programs. So the next, for the next topic, we have an application from White Tiger in Finland. And this is very interesting because it's from a hotel, which found out that this could be an interesting topic for them. And they organized the first Rainbow Week in Finland, and they are specializing on winter tourism. For this community, normally there are sun and beach destinations offered, but this was a winter program. With sauna, husky sledge, fishing, DJ, and all kind of stuff. And it was so successful that they are organizing it again in February 2020. And the whole hotel is booked for this Rainbow Week. And the interesting thing, which we should remember, is that they have European and US tour operators who are selling this program. Who would think that US tour operators are selling somewhere in remote Finland a package? So I think this is really worth to think about of the possibilities we have in our regions. And according to Spartacus, this is a tour operator and magazine for the community, Finland is the fourth most LGBT friendly. So it's also good to think about how open we are to everyone. Here you see some photos of beautiful winter in Finland and of the group that is doing all kind of nice things together.
Yeah, and then we come to Prussia. So we got an application from Lin. Lin is a beautiful peninsula in the Adriatic, at the Adriatic coast, and it's known as one of the most romantic destinations in Europe. The Lin Lagoon is a Natura 2000 destination and one of the five national parks in Croatia. And they offer really a lot of different possibilities also for seniors. You can go to the sea with a fisherman. They have a lot of bird watching activities because through the lagoon they have really birds that are nowhere else. You can learn a tambourine instrument, you can take part in professional photo courses or painting courses. You can visit the donkey farm. They also have salt picking. So salt is a really old topic there. You can also become a salt picker. They have a health resort with the healthy mud of the Adriatic. Interesting also is also the history of Lin. Lin was the first capital of Croatia. Nobody would expect. And it has the largest Roman temple on the eastern Adriatic coast. So you really have, the guests have a lot of possibilities to see interesting things and to do interesting things. And you can also, do all the sports that are possible on the water and outside of the water, kite surfing. Yesterday, all my colleagues were laughing because kite surfing is maybe not the sport that is very well known for seniors. But I have some friends who are doing it regularly in my age, so I think we can stay here. Bike riding, of course, horse riding, water sports. So I show you some of the pictures of me. They also have a very nice film, but I think it will be too long to show you. They have specialized also for couples who are renewing their wedding vows. So all the couples come and go again to the church and do their wedding vows again with all their guests. And this is, and then they make a romantic tour on the boat, for example. Or they do the mud play. And of course, bird watching is very important. And just having the nice atmosphere of this romantic place. And we have a second application from Croatia. This is Terme Tuhe. So the Terme, it means they have hot waters and they are offering special programs for active pensioners. They have certain nutrition, which is always labeled with an apple, so guests who are at the buffet know exactly, this is really good for health. They do morning exercises, guided morning exercises every day to start the day really active. They offer, of course, exercises with psychotherapists, with special equipment, aqua aerobic, guided bike and walking tours, and of course the healing water and the mud treatments are also very important for this program. And here we have some pictures. You see all the things to use, like balls and bands and so on. And you can have treatments. And you do water aerobics and so on. Yeah, and this is, I think, the last I showed to you. This is about the city of Otting, Belgium. It's a quite interesting city because it is not far from Louvain, the very well-known, famous city of Louvain, which has a huge university. And this Louvain, Louvain, I It was built on a field to host the Catholic University of Lumen. And it's completely new, and I think it was built in the 60s. And there were a lot of architects involved. And they made a city which is really of a human size, with a lot of green pedestrian areas and buildings that are for the people. And of course, there's a lot of young people, students, but it is really an interesting city, and they are specializing also on groups for older people, seniors, but also for people with problems to access. So they are doing guided tours not only for everybody, but especially also for people who have problems to, for example, walk. And you can even rent a wheelchair, which is pushed, and they're doing special wheelchair groups as well. So you can see, they send a lot of photos from the groups they are doing. You see the buildings are all quite new, rather futuristic and modern, but interesting. And here you see also a wheelchair group, which is really a good idea, because my son is working with handicapped people, and he says he has always lots of problems with the accessibility for people who are on wheelchairs. Yeah, so this was my presentation. You will get the info who is the winner in the afternoon, and also what the winner has from it. And if you have any questions to the EIP, so please ask. So are there any questions? If you need any information about the EIP, you please call me or send me an email. And I hope that at the next editions we have 50 or maybe at least 20 applications from Romania. Thank you very much.
Okay, so this is the end of our first session. We have a coffee break. I see you back at 11. Everything is served outside the conference. Dear guests, dear Eden family, I'm glad to welcome you to the 13th Eden Network meeting in Piatra Neamt in Romania. My name is Iulia Tărmulea, I am the project officer for Romania since 2009, and I'm very happy that after so many meetings, conferences, preparations, we are finally able to welcome you here in Neamt land. I will present you shortly, of course, the Eden activity in Romania since 2009 until the moment. End of it. So, the Eden project in Romania includes 34 destinations selected so far, including winner destinations, 8 winner destinations, and runner-up destinations. You can see on the screen the name, the nominees of this award for all Eden editions, starting from 2008, for the theme Tourism and Local Intangible Heritage. We have representatives from these destinations here with us. I would be happy if you could all meet together, talk, discuss future collaboration projects. It is one of the objectives of the Eden project, networking and developing long-lasting collaborations. So for 2009, the project was dedicated to tourism protected areas. We have five destinations awarded, 2010 five, 2012 there are four. It was a year when we recovered the lost Eden contest. And 2012 again, we had tourism and regeneration of physical sites. We had just one winner, Alba Iulia Municipality. 2013, accessible tourism for 2014, and
No.
Așa, ok. In 2017, we have again four destinations. Yes, some of them are here with us today. Just a short overview of the locations of our event destinations. As you can see, they are spread all over Romania with a higher concentration in the center of the country, in Transylvania, and also in Oltenia. We have in Vulcea and in Gorj counties, in the north in Maramureș, in Neamț, where we are here now, in Harghita, Covasna, in Suceava, the neighbor county. Coming down to south, we have in Buzău and Vrancea, and in southeast, on the shores of the Black Sea, in Tulcea County and Constanța County. We will, in the future, we will work on creating special packages according to this geographical location, so as for travel operators to be able to reach all destinations in packages with different thematic topics and local geographical specifications. About the meetings organized so far in Romania, they are the meetings gathering all the destinations selected. So the first one took place in Apuseni Nature Park in 2011. In the image you can see the director of Apuseni Nature Park, Mr. Alimoș. He had a presentation about the destination management and about the resources of Apuseni Nature Park. And further, we had another two other meetings. One in Marginimia Sibiului in 2017. It is a beautiful place in Sibiu County. It is a destination which includes several villages. It is not just one single location. And we were glad to have numerous participants and also one guest from the Eden Network Association, Mrs. Helga Bauer. And the most recent one in Suceava last year, we were happy again to be hosted by the County Council of Suceava. Mr. President of County Council was with us. He organized a very, very detailed program, including the discussions in the Neamț County Council headquarters and also field trips to Suceava Fortress, to Museum of Painted Eggs, and also a very, very surprising and useful activity. It was easy rafting, on Bistrița River. Another kind of activities that we organized is referring to the awarding ceremonies. After each selection of destinations, we organized an award ceremony with the occasion of the Romania Tourist Fair in Bucharest at Romexpo. You can see a few images from these awarding ceremonies, which were 8 so far. One from the early ones in 2009 with the designation for tourism protected areas. From 2012 we had 2 teams for which we organized the context. We had a nice surprise from Alba Iulia. The Roman guard defended us and was present at the award ceremony. And the last one in 2017, where you can see Mrs. State Secretary, Cristina Terpiață, was also present with Mr. Podato Mayoaga, also State Secretary. They awarded the diplomas to the winning and runner-up destinations. About promotion activities. We promoted event destinations through different channels. One of these is the YouTube channel, the official YouTube channel of the Ministry of Tourism, Romania Travel. All here there are, you can be accessed the videos created by the European Commission for the winner destinations. And also the videos and the presentation, of course. The event destinations are also present on the official travel website, romania.travel, and they have a special menu dedicated to the hidden project. Another new activity that was proposed during one of our meetings, Event Network meetings in Romania, the one in Marginia's Iului, we created an event events calendar with the most important events taking place at the event destinations. We distributed on Facebook and to the travel agencies association. And of course on the Facebook website of the Ministry of Tourism. There is also a Facebook page dedicated to Romania event destinations where we post information about recent projects, events, about prizes, and anything that is special, and we have information about our destinations. Regarding the brochures, there were 2 brochures printed so far. One for the first Eden project in 2008. They have also a DVD attached with a presentation, maps, movies. And the second one for the first Eden promotion project, financed by the European Commission, which took place between 2012-2013. We also included the Eden destinations in the promotion brochures created by the Ministry of Tourism with different themes, like, for example, the one dedicated to a journey into nature. We included Apuseni Nature Park with a special logo attached to the presentation. And also for a cultural journey, we included Horezu, the destination in Vulcea County, awarded for the tradition of pottery making. It is now also included in UNESCO heritage. A little bit about how the Eden destinations in Romania use the Eden logo. We encourage this during our meetings. We emphasize the importance of using the Eden logo as much as possible because it also means promoting your own award and also the whole network. For example, Sighetu Marmației, they use the Eden logo on different printed materials like Buzău Land, Suceava, they used it for a spider, yes, they use for the tourist fairs. Also on the website, we can find the Eden logo in Romania, like Rășinari, like Orezu, like Visit Neamț. On the header of official documents, on boards, and in Alba Iulia you can find it even on the kind of monument placed at the entrance of the city. We also implemented 3 projects with European funds so far. The first one took place in 2014-2015. With this project, we had the opportunity to develop our promotional activities, and we organized participation to tourist fairs both in Austria and in Romania. Austria was selected as our second main market of the project. We had the opportunity to present the destinations to media, to travel operators from Austria, and we will continue with our promotion in Austria during our present promotional project, which is taking place at the moment and will end next year. And also another project we are working on the moment is Romania Eden Contest for the theme Health and Wellbeing Tourist. We hope to have many applications for this edition. We will open it in May. We can organize other additional activities to the selection of the winner and runner-up destinations, like reinforcing the Eden network. We will have a meeting at the winner destination from this contest with a field trip. We will also have a study visit to a tourist fair with this team in Austria, in Wels, and also we will organize the award ceremony. It will be also with the tourist fair, with the occasion of the tourist fair in Romania in Bucharest. And last but not least, one activity that is connecting all our Eden destination, team building, which was first time emphasized by Suceava County Council with the easy rafting activity that I told you about. It was very entertaining and very useful for us. You can see also another image from this rafting, where we all tried to do our best to reach our destination. That would be all in short. Thank you very much for your attention, and I hope Eden, the largest network of destinations in the world, will not only grow, but will become stronger and stronger. And I'm glad Irma, as she said, I'm glad that there will be an evaluation year, next year. We can see how far have we come and what we achieved so far. So we can improve our activities, we can enhance our networking, and we can do more with the destinations that were selected so far until this moment. Thank you very much. I will invite our host destination, Neamțland, to present themselves and show us why they were selected as Eden destinations. But first, a short video.
Într-un rând, bună dimineața pentru colegii noștri români. Bine ați venit la Piatra Neamt. Bine ați venit la Neamț. Vă mulțumim și ne onorează prezența dumneavoastră aici. And this will be the moment that I will pass to English. It was only the welcoming word for our Romanian guests, okay? Thank you very much. Good morning and welcome to Neamț. Welcome to Piatra Neamț. We are glad and it's an honor for us for having you, the Eden board, and the member of the European, the representative of the European Commission. Neamț County. Neamț County is hosting this week the Eden Network meeting, the tourist destination of excellence from all over Europe, an event organized by the European Commission, the Romanian Ministry of Tourism, and the Neamț County Council. It is a great honor and an excellent opportunity for us to be together with the decision makers of the most representative tourist destination in Europe. It is a proof that Neamț County counts as a national and European level, being selected to host such an important event in the constant context of our country holding the rotating presidency of the Council of the European Union. Neamț County has a high tourist potential, both natural and anthropic, enhanced by a well-developed accommodation and laser infrastructure, and by the status of tourist resort of national interest held by the cities of Târgu Neamț and Piatra Neamț. There are more than 267 tourist accommodation units in Neamț, representing almost 4% of the national total and placing the country in the top 11 in Romania. The tourist accommodation capacity in operation is above 2 million places by days. Regarding the number of accommodated tourists, Neamț County is ranked 13th in national ranking with a total number of 238,000 tourists. At the territorial level, the highest tourist accommodation capacity was recorded in Ceahlău, over 1,500 places, and the most numerous arrivals in tourists were recorded in Piatra Neamț, over 54,000 people. The statistics you will see are from 2017, because the statistics for 2018 haven't arrived yet, so I'm sorry for this. The official record show that the foreign tourists are coming to Neamț County mainly from Israel, Italy, France, Spain, Germany, and the Republic of Moldova. Regarding the tourist accessibility, near Neamț County there are three international airports: Iași in the east, Suceava in the north, and Bacău in the southeast. The international destination from these three airports are London and Liverpool from in Iași, London and Liverpool from the United Kingdom, Tel Aviv from Israel, Paris from France, Rome, Italy, Rome, Milano, Torino, Venice, Bologna, Catania from Italy, Barcelona from Spain, Brussels from Belgium, Cologne, Munich and Dortmund from Germany, Larnaca from Cyprus, Thessaloniki from Greece, Eindhoven from the Netherlands, Bingen from Denmark and Vienna from Austria. Also for Bacău and Suceava, there are flights to Rome, Milano, Bologna and Bergamo to Italy, and to the UK, London and Liverpool. Also Madrid, Dublin and Brussels are on that list, on those lists. So, Neamt County is located in a privileged area in the northeast region from the point of view of the pan-European corridors being crossed to the Roman municipality by the pan-European Corridor 9 railway and railroad branch, linking the north and east of Europe. I will use this so it will be easier for our... So, this is Neamt on the map, this is Roman. We have a north-south axis which links Poland to Turkey, Istanbul, and we have a west-east axis which links the Western Europe to the Republic of Moldova. The most important artery crossing Neamt County are European Road E85 from Lithuania to Greece and the European Road E583 which links E85 to Yash. Few current trends in tourism. Promoting and capitalizing on the tourist attraction of the territory of the continent, Neamt is nowadays one of the most attractive tourist destinations in landmarks of Romania. Leisure activities are especially popular in the area. Major investments in restoration and extension of the tourist infrastructure. Organizing events with local, national and international participation. Establishing partnership with other international entities, even working in the field of tourism, promoting and development. You will see in the next few slides a SWOT analysis that we use in the County Council with strengths, weaknesses. I will not read it because you can do these things on your own. On the opportunity level, I'd like to say that the admission of Neamt County as a member of the Eden Network is an opportunity. We see it as an opportunity. We hope to transform this into a greater opportunity. So, these are the tourist objectives and accommodation units that are concentrated in Neamt in four tourist areas. Piatra Neamt, in which we held this meeting. Because with the massive chapleau, again you see laser, this is because and chapleau, this is the place you went and visited last night, are located in the southwest of the county. These are because and chapleau, Piatra Neamt, of course, Turku Neamț area, where you will go tomorrow, and Roman area. These are images from Turku Neamț. The Neamț fortress, the museum you will see, the maps, and the bison. The main tourist attraction in Turku Neamț are, as listed, Neamț fortress, Vânător Neamț Natural Park, Lake Vâșdel, museums and memorial houses, and of course, very important for us, the monasteries, the Orthodox monasteries. Neamț, Secu, Sicăstria, Gavia, and Varadnic. Piatra Neamț area. This is a landscape image from Piatra Neamț, from the Kozla Mountain, which we'll visit tonight if the weather will allow us. We hope so. These are the main tourist attraction in Piatra Neamț. The Royal Court, which you will see tomorrow morning. The Royal Church and the Tower of Stephen the Great. Museum and Memorial Houses. The Youth Theatre. And the wooden synagogue. The Picaz area and the Chapla Mountains. The Don. And the main tourist attractions are the Picaz Gorges, the Sugo Gorges, Chapla National Park, Duro Resort, the lake is Vorm Muntelui, ruins of the Prince Palace, and the wooden churches in Farkashai and Vicazu Ardele. In Roman, we have the History Museum, the Art Museum, the Natural Science Museum, churches and cathedrals. These are a few ideas of mountain tourism. Neamt County Council contribution to tourist development in the region has a significant contribution by the efforts of instituting being a semi-stadium focused on achieving different objectives. Tourism promotion of Neamt County using several promotion methods and techniques by distributing printed materials, posting articles on social network, organizing various events and participating in national and international tourism fairs. Promoting sustainable exploitation of tourist attraction in Neamt County, creating partnerships with foreign associations in order to boost tourism promotion. Here are some images from Piatra Neamt. I was saying you about the monasteries. Some of them dating back to 1210. So we have a few landmarks to see. So maybe three days in Neamt. Very. Agrotourism also very important for us as a mountain county, also for Suceava or Maramureș. The Vânător Neamt Natural Park is the host of a great density of natural, cultural and historical attraction. These are the bisons which were reintroduced in Vânători, I don't know, maybe a couple of years ago, I don't know exactly. And of course, leisure tourism. With all the activities that a tourist can have in Piatra Neamt and more generally in Neamt. These are a few of the main events organized by the Neamt County Council. Each year, we organize these events. The Hope Chest Art Festival, which is in May. The Days of the Fortress from Târgu Neamt, which was organized as a medieval festival. And of course, the Chakra Mountain Festival, which is in August. I was saying a few minutes ago about the contribution to tourist development in the region. Unfortunately, as you saw, our main events are all concentrated in the summer. We have long periods of winter, long periods of spring and autumn, and a short summer. As I was saying you, Neamt County Council permanently maintains contact with the citizens in order to find out their needs and expectations and to meet them with innovative solutions. Both on the social impact of each event and the quality of its management are thoroughly assessed. Also, we are a regular participant in the Romanian Tourism Fair, and in the last year we have participated in international tourist fairs such as Expo Real in Munich, Economic Forum in Crinica, and Tourism Leisure Hotels in Chișinău. These are the main promotion methods and techniques we use at the moment. Also, I would like to point out that in the present we are working in the new master plan of tourism for the next years. The site visitneamt.com and the YouTube channel. The app, we are very proud with our mobile app, which is working for about 1 month, 2 months. These are kind of technical issues, but I will let them pass on, so maybe which one of you are interested in them. I was saying about the mobile app. Krangaland Theme Park is an investment we want to make in Turku Neamt. It is about, we estimate an investment of 60 million euros in a theme park with multiple leisure activities, one holiday village, the park rest area, playgrounds for children, adventure park, bike, roller skates and running track, camping and caravan areas, sport and relaxation area, also Legoland type areas, spectacle area and a hippodrome. The Neamt Gate, it is a project that we hope to finish implementing this year. They are meant to present a symbolic manner the historical roots, culture and spiritual specific of the area. Also, we have European funded projects of 5 to 6 million euros in implementation. And we, the Neamt County Council, are the administration of the Chahlo National Park. So we are working with the administration of the park in implementing a sustainable development for the natural area and for to tourism, not to affect the ecosystems and vice versa. Thank you very much for your attention, and I wish you a pleasant stay in Neamt. Thank you.
We have a little surprise for you. I invite our representative from Aramureș. He had prepared something, a short video, with a special way of presenting the Eden logo. What I'm talking about.
It's quick, it's effective. First of all, I would like to thank you for hosting us here, and it's important for us to visit Neamt officially. Unofficially, we did it a couple of times and we loved it. Yes, we do share common history. I don't know how much you remember from yesterday, but the beginnings of this region in Romania was established by a guy from Maramureș that came on the back of the horse. And we will probably develop a common project regarding this at one point, maybe starting this year. Let's see the movie. It's actually presenting our Eden destination. I didn't know when I was making the movie that I will impress so many people that are effectively the Eden family. You probably remember that the name of the Eden destination is Țara Chioarului, and this is the surprise. I managed to animate a little bit the Eden, and maybe we can use this in the materials from now on. I represent two areas that are both Eden. So when I decided to come here, I had to bring with me, let's say, the background and the culture. And Maramureș can be explained by a couple of letters. And as you know, Eden has a very important message in this logo, European Destination of Excellence. Well, we took this idea and we spelled the name of our county, which is now Eden County, because it has two Eden regions included. And we copied this idea, so every letter in the name Maramureș makes sense. And if you can start the video from the beginning, we can see it. Unfortunately, my colleague from Sighet could not be here, but this is why I brought you Maramureș. Cătălin spoke a lot about Neamț and about the cultural heritage. They also have beautiful music and probably will enjoy this during the day. I will also use an international word just to make it more European. Yeah, so this is Maramureș, the county I come from. And, you know, pictures, they can tell a lot of stories, but videos nowadays, they can make a difference. And this was a project that we developed together, preparing for Eden. So these are both destinations in one movie. Please enjoy. Quickly, just a recipe. You take two young tourists and you just let them run around freely in a county called Maramureș, or it could be Neamț, or it could be Suceava. And they will enjoy the area and they will somehow empower people to visit. And these are our, let's say, attractions from Țara Chioarului, the first Eden destination. Most of the things that we discussed, ecotourism, bike-friendly areas, you can see all of them. And we also have an app, it's called Visit Maramureș, as Visit Neamț, you could see, they also promoted this. This is the 21st century, so you need this in order to discover an area. This is a living museum, it's in the heart of Baia Mare, our municipality. And as I was saying in Bucharest a couple of weeks earlier, yes, you can feed the chicken. The famous wooden church is some, let's say, workshops where you can sit down and start discovering about the common culture that we share in Europe. And by the way, we do have, before Google Translate, we had the horinca or palinca, which is a strong drink that finally, after you drink it, you don't need a translator anymore. And this is sometimes good for the translator, sometimes it's a pain, but still. This is the Mary Cemetery, so you have many beautiful places in Romania, many beautiful places in the world, but you only have one Mary, one happy place, it's called Mary Cemetery. And yes, it is in one of the Eden destinations. And we come back now to the municipality of Baia Mare, which after being awarded Eden destination diploma and also after becoming part of the big Eden family, it's now welcoming a lot of tourists. You will all have access to this video also by downloading the app Visit Maramureș. I would like to thank all of you for your attention and all of you for being here. And I have a very, let's say, small story. We don't have customs, but you had to fly over here. So I just took my car and I drove and I discovered how beautiful coming from the northwest it is to come east. And I saw in Xavier's presentation, east of Eden, but I would say it's Eden in the east. Probably this would be the best translation. And I also had from Helga a beautiful presentation about the family coming to a country and not forgetting about it. And now you are here, so you can just send a message to them with whatever place we are going to visit in beautiful Neamț, and then they will agree with you that you came to the right place. Yeah, I'm glad that you also visited Maramureș. You're always welcome. Yeah, thank you all. And yes, when you come here, they will ask you, is it business or pleasure? Because this is, you know, the customs. You just say family reunion, because I think that this is the place for it. And thank you, Julia, for all the good things that you do.
By Julia, the city with the Eden monument at the entrance.
Alba Iulia was selected winner destination for the team regeneration of physical sites. And you can see how they regenerate the old fortress. They were also invited during our last conference in Bucharest last week. Alba Iulia had a presentation regarding digital tourism because they have advanced in this field very much. Thank you, Alba Iulia. And now I invite Xavier to open the discussion for hidden destinations.
As we have time, we will take time. Thank you very much for your presentation, Dan. Is it, can I call you that way?
Dan?
I saw you.
It was a pleasure that I shared with you because, as I told you, I went to Maramuresh 10 years ago and it was really nice to see it again. It has changed a bit. So, how are you?
Well,
three people answers. How are you? Oh, that's better. I'm sorry, but you can take some snow because I think I will drink some polinka and you don't need any more to translate. Then you talk about it, I hope we will drink it. Yeah? So do you have any questions to or different presentator, a different person, Julia, Katalin, and Dan? Do you have some question to them? No? Okay. So I will ask you questions. You had a question? Oh, to from Finland, please. You need a microphone? You have a big voice.
So, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Tuomo. I come from the deep forests of Kainuu, Finland. And while hearing the presentations this session that just ended, I was wondering, there was a gentleman presenting, you were telling about some problems with cooperation between different key players. You were showing the challenges that and threats and so on. And I'm just wondering that has there been any processes done to activate the cooperation between restaurant owners or service providers or other key players in the region to make products that everyone can benefit from? Has there been processes, development projects or something like that?
Thank you for the question. Establishing connection from with different stakeholders in tourist activity is a continuous problem for us. It's a continuous activity. We enhanced in the presentation that we have this problem about continuous cooperation, especially between public sector that we represent here and private sector. But I'm happy to say that in the last year there are good signs that private sectors are willing to collaborate with us in obtaining good products that we could sell, that we want to sell, mostly to European markets, but not only to the European market, we are in the eastern side of the European Union, so we have a market in the east, we should look at that market and Middle East, of course, in the North, in the East. So yes, there are improvements, but these are slow improvements, and it takes time, it takes a lot of work, and it takes a lot of collaboration between us. Thank you.
If I may add, so that in our region, which is a very